businesses are using, you know, not necessarily in entertainment, but how businesses are using VR and AR to save, you know, save a lot of money in terms of training. So huge, you know, from Lockheed Martin to Boeing to GE, who are making double digit cost savings using AR and VR to train people, and for manufacturing, which is not, you know, a little bit out of the scope of CAM certainly, but it's an important thing to be looking to in terms of monetization and a good model, just in terms of where how the technology is generating revenue or cost savings.
Just add,
we have some video. Here we go, roll video.
One day Goldilocks came upon a cottage hidden in the forest.
This was a demo that we put together for WWDC. Apple gave us early access to ARKit, and we built this short storybook. Basically, uses your voice to allow you to read out loud, and as you do, it builds the storyline in your bedroom around you. So we are starting to experiment with AR storytelling. We think there's something very exciting and interesting there. It is very different from VR. But I think, obviously, the total addressable market, talking about monetization, is the orders of magnitude larger. But I think from a creative standpoint, what you can do is really exciting because you can actually interact with your environment. You can make something intrinsically personal that's happening right there in front of you. And we're starting with some experiments with kids with just they're losing it because this is adding a magical layer to their reality, which is something I dreamed of for sure as a kid. So it's cool to see it happening.
So you mentioned you're working to early access to ARKit. So we're talking about, and obviously you guys get early access to lots of the technological innovation. So how is technology, working with tech companies, you both have worked at tech companies as well, most influence your storytelling tool sets?
Yeah, I mean, we are an industry that is intrinsically linked to the development of these technologies. So getting early access to them and being able to prototype and experiment and play. And ideally, the best relationship is one where we can actually deliver feedback and influence the trajectory of that technology. That's certainly what drove me to work at Google back when I did, was actually sitting with the people who are making the decisions and pointing out alternative use cases. And I think we almost have a responsibility to try to direct technology and technology companies towards human-centric applications, because if we don't, and for a future we may not want to live in.
That's the world.
What technology advances are you most looking forward to in the future that you think will help drive the industry forward?
Laundry list of things.
It's a long list.
But some of them are very complex and difficult, physics problems, like optics advancements, and some of them are very simple, like let's track our feet. Like, it's really great to actually have full body embodiment, and we can do that very easily, but there has to be a financial incentive to build that into the product. As part of that conversation that we're having. But there, I think we're seeing some of those advancements, having tetherless systems, having, there are a few devices I mentioned that are coming out in the nearish future, which will allow you to have wireless and full body 6 degrees of freedom. I think having 3 degrees of freedom is really limiting. So I'm really excited more people are getting access to VR. And but I also think for you to truly have a great interaction, you need to feel like you're there. Having your physicality. So the technologies that are making it even more human, I spent most of my life on a computer with bad posture, squinting. What's exciting to me is this is now a computing paradigm that will push us past that, I think, and allow us to tap into the bodies that have taken millions of years to evolve into dealing with reality and allow them to expand in a more natural way.
The thing about technology is it's what you do with it. It's what you choose to make. If you ask a good engineer, hey, if I wanted to blah, 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 could you do it? And the answer will always be yes. How much money and how much time, right? And so I think the interesting thing is when you see these technologies first appear, it's amazing how many controllers that are already available for VR that are like guns. Like, is that the best we can do? There's so much more thinking that has to be done around the humanization, what Aaron was saying, of the experience. And some may think that's boring. The truth is that's where all of the riches can be found, because to make the experience, essentially to allow us to be more human in that environment than we are, that's a big win. And I think the other thing is that our interactions with technology today have in many ways made us less human, unfortunately, I think. I mean, you know, like Facebook has connected the world. So like, we're connected. Like, I'm connected enough, you know? No more connected, please, you know? I actually want to talk to people and actually relate and grow and learn and thrive as a human now, not just be connected, right?
Some of the experiences here is at Tribeca, or when I did Lamb Child, or even what we just experienced together.